Estimating process capability. The X-bar and R-charts provide information about the performance or process capability of the process. The process standard deviation may be estimated using this equation. Okay, sigma is the standard deviation. Sigma cap means it is the estimator of standard deviation. So this cap symbol represents it is the estimator. Okay, estimated standard deviation. Okay, that is given by R bar by D2. So R bar, so this is the average of ranges of various samples or subgroups. Okay, this already we determined for the problem which we considered in previous class, that is related to Rdbeck process used for manufacturing semiconductor. Okay, so that we discussed in previous class. Okay, same value we are considering. R bar we know from the control chart. That is 0.32521. D2, you will get it directly from the table. So at the end of the textbook, okay, so you find appendix, so in that there is table 6. In the table 6, you will get the value for D2. Okay, if you know the sample size, so here for this case, sample size is 5. That means small n value is 5. For 5, you can find out D2 from the table. Okay, this is the table. So here, sample size is 5. Okay, so D2, this is the column of D2. So row 5 means its value is 2.326. Okay, this is the value of D2. So 2.326. It is this we are going to get from the table as I shown here. Okay. So then if you substitute, you will get the value of standard deviation, that is 0.1398 microns. Okay. Next, we are going to make use of this value to find out process capability. Next, fraction of non-conforming. Non-conforming means defectives. Okay. So out of 100% of what you have produced, okay, what percent are defective? So that you can get with the help of this fraction of non-conforming. Okay, if the specification limits on flow width are, so 1.50 plus or minus 0.50 microns. Okay, this is the desired value. 1.50 is the target. So it is having a tolerance limit of 0.5 microns. So that means the range is between 1 to 2. Okay, 1 to 2 microns is the range, where 0.5 microns is the tolerance limit, plus or minus 0.5. So minus 0.5 means it will be 1 microns. Plus 0.5 means it will be 2 microns. So the acceptable limit or the specification limits are between 1 and 2. So whatever the values that will fall between 1 and 2, so they are acceptable. If some values fall beyond that, they are which we cannot accept. Okay. The control chart data may be used to describe the capability of the process to produce wafers relative to the to these specifications. Assuming that flow width is a normally distributed random variable with mean 1.5056. So mean means, so it is X bar, which we already determined. Okay, so for the this problem, that is problem related to flow width in the case of semiconductor manufacturing. Okay, next, standard deviation. In previous slide we determined standard deviation, that is sigma cap is equal to R bar by D2. Okay, we got this value. So by making use of mean value and the standard deviation value, we can estimate number fraction of defectives, that is fraction of non-conforming wafers produced. So this is the procedure followed. Okay, so this is based on the principles of normal distribution. Okay, so if you have gone through the fundamentals of normal distribution, you can understand it in a better way. Then also need not worry, I will explain the procedure. Okay, so P is the fraction of non-conforming. Okay, so P of X less than 1. Okay, so here we are considering fraction of non-conforming defectives. Okay, when we are going to consider wafers produced that defective is if the value of the flow width is less than 1 micron or if the value of flow width is greater than 2 micron, then it will be considered as defective, non-conforming. So first you are considering the probability of getting wafers where flow width is less than 1 micron. Okay, that is the meaning of x less than 1. That means, so 1.50 minus 0.50 means it will be 1. If it is less than 1, that is a defective. Okay, that is one possible way of getting defective, that is getting flow width less than 1 micron. Next, there is one more probability where getting wafers, values of this flow width for wafers greater than 2. Again, if you consider the positive side of the tolerance limit, that is 1.50 plus 50, it will be 2. If it is greater than 2, so that is also a defective that you are considering. What is the probability that you are going to get wafers flow width, so greater than 2. Okay, so if you add these two values, so you are going to get the overall probability of getting non-conforming wafers. It may be towards negative, that is less than 1 micron, or it may be towards positive, that is more than 2 microns. So both are defectives according to given specification limits for flow width. So based on that, we can write this equation. Okay, so P, fraction non-conforming, so P of x less than 1 means, so already we discussed, plus P of x greater than 2 microns. Okay, next, how we are going to get this equation? Okay, what is that equation that you will understand here? So this is the equation, P of x less than or equal to a. Okay, so that can be written as pi of a minus mu by sigma. Okay, mu is the mean, process mean, and sigma is the standard deviation. These two values are given. Mean value is 1.5056, it is mu. Standard deviation value is 0.1398. Okay, next, a is, so the value under consideration. Okay, so in this case, so a will be 1. In this case, a will be 2. So here, so x, so less than or equal to a. So here, x less than 1. So a value will be 1 for this case. Okay. So phi of a is 1. Then mu value is this one. Sigma value is 0.1398. We are substituting this. Okay. Next. So you have p of x greater than, but this is an equation for less than or equal to a. So next, in order to get the equation for x greater than a, greater than or equal to a, so you have to apply the rule of symmetry. Okay, so you have to take it symmetry. That means 1 minus p of x less than or equal to a. So that will give you p of x greater than or equal to a. That is this condition. So that's why we are considering 1 minus phi of a minus mu sigma. So here, based on this consideration. Okay. Next, so 1 minus 5. So again, a value for this is 2. Mu value is same. And sigma value is also same. Here, this 5. So a minus mu by sigma, it can be called as z. Here, based on this, you can say a minus mu by sigma is z. Next, it can be called as phi of z. Okay, for phi of z, we have a table from where we will get some values. Okay, where phi is the cumulative distribution function of the standard normal distribution. Okay, so you are going to substitute these values and you will get phi of minus 3.61660 for this. Next, phi of 3.53648 for this. Okay, next, how we are going to get this value? How we are going to get 0.00015 and how we are going to get this 0.00980? This is very important. These two values you are going to get from the table. Okay, it is available in the table 2 of the appendix of this textbook. Okay, so that I will explain. Okay, we know how we got this equation, what does this mean, and also we discussed about how to substitute the values, how we are going to get this, and also this. Now, so here I am going to explain how we are going to get 0.00015 for this value. Okay, so this is phi of minus 3.61660. okay, so before that, so you should consider this point. Appendix table 2 gives only probability to the left of positive values of z. So here it is a table which will give you values of phi of z. So phi of whatever there, so this is z, this is phi. Phi of z values you can get with the help of table 2. Now, so these values are for positive numbers, okay, positive values. But here we have a negative value, -3.61660. It is a negative value, but directly we don't get values for a negative value of z. Okay, so what we should do is we can utilize the symmetry property of the normal distribution to evaluate probability. Symmetry property is, so you have to consider 1 minus this value. So for positive 3.61660, you will get some value in the table. So consider 1 minus that value. So that will give you this one. Okay. Now, first I will get the value for +3.61660 from this table. Okay. So here we know z value. So it is 3.6. It will start from 3.6. So I will consider 3.6. Okay, this one. Next, so the next position is 3.61. So here we have to round it up to two decimal points. Okay, that means so we cannot consider all the 5 points. So we have to round it off. So we can round off 3.61660 as 3.62. Okay, we can round it off as 3.62. Now I will search for the corresponding value for 3.62 in the table. So this is 3.6. So this one is for 3.60. This column is for 3.61. This column is for 3.62. Okay, which I needed. Okay, so 3.62. Okay, this is the value. So the value for 3.62, that is positive 3.62, is 0.99985 is the value from the table. Okay, but I need to find the value for -3.62. okay, now I will make use of this symmetry property, that is, so 1 minus 0.9985, okay, 1 minus this, okay, so that will give you the value for -3.62, that is 0.00015. So you will get 0.00015. Okay, next. So I will consider one more point. So phi of 3.53648. Okay, for this is a positive value. Directly I can get from the table. Again, I should round off it to two decimal points. Okay, this 3.536 can be round off as what value? So it can be round off as 3.54. Okay, so now I should search for 3.5. okay, this is the row of 3.5. again it is 3.54. okay, so this is 0.00, so this is this column, so here it is 3.54. okay, it will be for 3.54. okay, for 3.54 the value is 0.9980. So 0.9980. We are considering it as it is because it is for a positive value, positive 3.53648. Whereas here we consider 1 minus value from the table because it is negative. In case of negative, for where we should apply symmetry property, we should get the value for corresponding value for the same positive number, then we should subtract it by 1 minus that value, that will give you this. Okay, if you have any doubt regarding this, you can ask, I will clarify your doubts. So nimge idanna artha agila doubts ide andre you can ask. Okay, if you have understood, I will continue. Okay, so by following the procedure, by getting the values of phi of z from the table, so ultimately we will get a value. That value is 0.00035. Okay, so the meaning of this is, so this is for one, a maximum of one value. So if you want to convert it into percentage, multiply it with 100, you will get it for 100%. Okay, the meaning of this is, so about 0.35% of the wafers produced will be outside the specifications. Okay, for this mu standard deviation and for these specification limits, so we are going to get 0.35% of the wafers outside the specification. That means they are defectives. Okay, if you consider it for million, per million it will be 350 parts. For 10 lakhs it will be 350 parts. Only 350 parts are defective for 10 lakhs. Okay. Next, process capability ratio. Okay, you can find out process capability ratio using this equation. Cp is equal to upper specification limit minus lower specification limit by 6 sigma. Okay. So in this case, so we know the upper and lower specification limit. So 2 is the upper and 1 micron is the lower specification limit. Substitute the values. So you will get some value. Process capability ratio is 1.192. Next, how you are going to interpret this value? What do you understand by this value? Okay, that is also very important. If you get a CP value, that is process capability ratio value, more than 1, that indicates, so the process is almost in control and you are going to get only few defectives. If even if you get a process capability ratio equal to 1, okay, so the process will be in control. If you get a process capability ratio less than 1, that is problematic. That means that will result in production of more number of defectives. Okay, that is the meaning. More than 1 or equal to 1 is a good value. Okay, if it is less than 1, so that is problematic. Okay, this implies that the natural tolerance limits in the process, that is 3 sigma above and below. So since we are considering 6 sigma here, so 3 sigma, totally 6 deviation points, 3 above and 3 below, are inside the lower and upper specification limits. Consequently, a moderately small number of non-conforming wafers will be produced. Since again, this 3 sigma limits will cover only 99.73% of the total population. Okay, so then obviously there will be few defectives. Okay, since they are considering only plus or minus 3 sigma limits. Okay, but then also if it is greater than 1, so you are going to get only few number of defectives. Next, so after determining the value of CP, you can find out the percentage of the specification band that the process uses up. That means even though the specification limits for this flow width is plus or minus 0.5, okay, that is the bandwidth is 1 to 2, but whether the points or the flow width values fall between 1 to 2, if it starts from 1 and if it goes till 2, it will make use of 100% band. Okay, suppose even though it is having 1 to 2 range, okay, if it falls between 1.1 to 1.9, then it is making use of only 80% of the available band. Suppose if all the flow width values fall between 1.2 to 1.8, even though the actual specification limit is 1 to 2, then So this the band to which it is points are falling, that will be 60% of the available band. Okay, like that we will evaluate. For that type of evaluation, we make use of this equation, the percentage of the specification bond band that the process uses up, that is given by P is 1 by Cp into 100. Okay, for this case, it is 83.89. That means even though the range fall between 1 to 2, so it is not making use of complete range. Okay, the process uses up about 84% of the specification band. Okay, process fallout and the process capability ratio. That means this will help you to understand what we discussed earlier. Okay, so how to interpret the Cp values. Okay, what do you mean by getting Cp more than 1, getting Cp equal to 1, getting Cp less than 1. Okay, so Cp greater than 1. So for the previous example, we got 1.192. Okay, so that is greater than 1. The process uses up much less than 100% of the tolerance band. Again, since we got a Cp value of 1.192, so the process is using only 84% of the specification band. That means it is less than 100%. So that is the meaning. The process used up much less than 100% of the tolerance band, and the number of defective produced are also very less. If Cp is equal to 1, the process uses up all the tolerance band, that is 100%, for a normal distribution. So it is about 0.27% non-conforming unit. Since we are considering only plus or minus 3 sigma units, so the area under the normal distribution curve will be will cover 99.73%. Okay, remaining will be out of these limits. Okay, so that is the meaning. Next, Cp less than 1, the process uses up more than 100% of the tolerance band, a large number of non-conforming units will be produced. Non-conforming means defective. So if it is less than 1, again, so more number of points will lie outside this. Okay, so that will result in more number of defectives. All the cases assume that the process is centered at the midpoint of the specification band. In many situations, this will not be the case. So here you can see, so we assume that the process fall at the midpoint, at the mu, but there may be shift practically. So usually there will be shifts. Okay, for that case, it is not applicable. These considerations are not applicable. Okay, next, a revision of control limits and center lines. Okay, so already we determined control limits for one example and we plotted X bar and R chart. Okay, suppose after plotting X bar and R chart, okay, if there are few points which are outside these control limits, okay, then we need to revise them. Okay, that we discuss. The effective use of any control chart will require periodic revision of the control limits and center lines. So this period may be 1 week, 1 month. So after few months, it depends. Okay, so quality engineers, people who have knowledge of process and its variation, okay, they will make this decision, okay, when to revise this limits. Okay, when the R chart is out of control, that is, if any of the points fall out of the control limits, okay, the out of control points are eliminated and a revised value of R bar is computed. Suppose if out of 25, okay, if one or two, if two points are out of the control limits, okay, then you have to eliminate these two. Next, you have to find R bar by considering ranges of only 23 samples instead of 25. That is the procedure you need to follow. This value is then used to determine new limits and center line on the R chart and new limits on the X bar chart. Okay, if you get some points out of the R chart, okay, so you have to eliminate those samples and you have to find out R bar by eliminating range values of those two. Okay, this value is then used to determine new limits and center line on the R chart and new limits on the X bar chart. So this will tighten the limits on both charts, making them consistent with the process standard deviation sigma, consistent with use of revised R bar in the relationship with R bar by D2. Okay, so this will tighten means, so initially we might be having broader limits, now it will be tightened. Okay. This estimate of sigma could be used as the basis of a preliminary analysis of process capability. So already we determined CP values and standard deviation value using this equation. Okay, so that is the next. So this is very important. The X bar chart monitors between sample variability, variability in the process over time. Okay, so and the R chart measures within sample variability. So that means you are taking maximum to minimum. So that means you are considering the difference inside the sample, within the sample. Okay, if you are considering number of trials in a sample, okay, or if it is a subgroup, you are considering the items in the subgroup itself. Okay, that is within sample or within subgroup variability. For that, we use R chart to monitor variability of the process. We make use of X bar chart. Okay, next, phase two operation of the X bar and R chart. So whatever we discussed or whatever you plot in the previous class, that is the phase one of X bar and R charts. Okay, by considering initial set of values of a production process. Okay, so we will plot. So that is the phase one. Phase two is again continuation. Okay, so after producing few more units of product, okay, you will include those values also, you will evaluate. That is the phase two. Okay, once a set of reliable control limits is established, then the control chart is used for monitoring future production. That means reliable control limits means if all the points plot inside the R chart, okay, no problem. If some of the points plot beyond the R chart, you have to eliminate them and you have to revise the control limits. Then for the new set of, for the revised control limits, so if you get all points inside the control charts or inside the upper and lower control limits, okay, then those are considered as reliable control limits. In a control chart, if points are falling out beyond the control limits, they are not reliable. Okay, so reliable control limits means, so all points are within the upper and lower control limit. So once a set of reliable control limits is established, then the control chart is used for monitoring future production. This is called phase two control chart usage. Okay, now we consider phase two control chart usage. Okay, earlier in previous class, we plotted control chart X bar and R chart for first 25 samples. Okay, now we are extending the same since we got okay, if you observe the control charts which we got for first 25 samples, okay, so all the points are within the upper control limit and lower control limit. Okay, so that means it is, we can say that, or we can assume that the process is in control. So here also, so all the points are within the control limits. Okay, and we considered only 25 samples. Okay, 25 subgroups are samples here. Okay, so this is the data. So for 25 samples, flow with data for first 25 samples are subgroups. Okay, now in phase two, so we are considering data of further production. Okay, so we are considering 26 to 45. Again, we are considering 20 more samples. Okay, again, within each sample, we are considering five wafers. Okay, five different wafers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or you can consider this as five trial values. Okay, now again, same procedure. So you have to find out X bar and R values. Okay, You know the procedure to find out x bar value. You have to add all the 5 values, divide by 5, that will be x bar 26. Next, you have to find out x bar 27, add all the 5 values, divide by 5, that will be x bar 27. Similarly, add these 5 values, divide by 5, that is x bar 28. Like that, you will get x bar values for 45, till 45 you will get. Then find the value of range. Okay, range is the difference between maximum and minimum value. Okay, suppose if you want to find out range for sample number 26, that is R26. Okay, so you have to consider maximum minus minimum. Okay, in the row of 26, okay, which is the maximum value? Okay, now to find out R26, you have to consider maximum value and minimum value. So which is the maximum value?
1.6206.
Okay, 1.6206 is the maximum value. Then which is the minimum value?
1.4483.
Here 1.4303. Okay, if you don't observe properly and if you end up with taking incorrect minimum value, okay, so no one can help you. Okay, you must be very careful. If you in the problem, okay, in few problems directly they will give you x bar and r value, so then you need not do all these things. In few problems they will give you all this data, you have to find out x bar and r. In such cases you have to evaluate carefully. Okay, each and every row you have to evaluate carefully. So here this is the maximum value and this is the minimum value. If we take the difference of that, we will get R26. Similarly, we can find out R27. Okay, for R27, so maximum will be 27. Okay, similarly you can follow the procedure. Okay, for I told you how to find out x bar values. Okay, so add all and divide by 5, you will get these values. Next, r value, that is range, it is the difference of maximum and minimum. See, 1.6206 minus 1.4303, that will give you this value. Similarly for the second row, that is for R27, for sample 27, range for sample 27, so 1.6899 is the maximum value. Then 1.3358 is the minimum value and this is the difference. Like that you can find out range values. Okay, so after finding x bar I and ri, so here you are not you are considering the same limits, you are considering same thing, just you are continuing plotting control charts. Okay, you assume that the process is in control and you are not revising the control limits. For the same set of control limits you will extend plotting x bar and r charts. Okay, so control limits remain same, since for the previous 25 samples you got all points within the control limits, you are not going to revise them. Okay, so you instead what you are going to do is, so earlier you plotted x bar and r chart for 25 samples, now you will extend that for 45 samples. Okay, so you will extend it to 40. Okay, now so we are ending it at 45. Okay, here also we are ending at 45. Okay, now so after plotting mean values, okay, till 25, okay, 20, 21, 22, 20, 25. Okay, so the process according to the location of the points, we can conclude that the process was in control. Okay, but so here you can see there are few points outside the control limits. So here these two points are outside the control limits. Okay, so point number 43 and 45 are outside the control limits. Okay, so now we cannot say that the process is in control because two points are outside the control limits. It requires evaluation. Okay, then if you apply the sensitizing rules, then also you can find 3, 6, 8, totally 8 points. Okay, 8 consecutive points are above mean, above central line. Okay, this is also another indication of something which is going wrong with the process. Okay, so based on this, so quality engineer need to evaluate, okay, what is happening, why, so why you are getting values like this. Okay, it need evaluation. Okay, so like that we are going to interpret control charts. Next, control limits, specification limits, and natural tolerance limits. So, as you have seen in few cases, we use upper specification limit, lower specification limit. At few cases, we make use of the term upper control limit, lower control limit. Okay, what is the difference between control limit and specification limit? Do both are same, or is there a difference? Okay, control limit, specification limit, what is the difference? Okay, usually specification limits are decided externally. That means, okay, it may be customer, he may give specifications. Okay, you have to manufacture this component for this specification limits. Okay, so that is decided, most of the time that is decided externally, whereas control limits, it is depending on that particular process. Okay, so control limits will be based on process, whereas specification limits are decided externally. Okay, the control limits are driven by the natural variability of the process, that is by the natural tolerance limits of the process. Specification limits on the other hand are determined externally. So this may be set by management of the company, the manufacturing engineers, customers, product developers or designers. There is no mathematical or statistical relationship between control limits and specification limits since it is decided externally. Okay, next, charts based on standard values. This is not included in the syllabus, so you can also plot control charts, okay, based on standard values. So when it is possible to specify standard values for the process mean and standard deviation, we may use these standards to establish the control limits for X bar and R without analysis of past data. That means you need not find out X bar, R bar, all those things. Just if you know mu and standard deviation values, so you can plot control chart. Okay, so that is for that, these are the equations. Okay, similarly you can plot R chart, and this D2, D1, small D2 values you will get from the table if you know the sample size. Okay, next, interpretation of X bar and R charts. Okay, you will plot a control chart, then what conclusion you are going to get, or what understanding you can gain, okay, by plotting control chart, that is also very important. For that, some aspects already we discussed. We can make use of sensitizing rules, okay, and also we can analyze patterns, okay, whether it is cyclic pattern, okay, or how the points are falling, whether they are above, below. So there are many considerations. Okay, so these are few more considerations. cyclic pattern, mixture pattern, shifting, process level, trend, stratification, we will discuss. Okay, cycles on the chart, already we discussed about cyclic trend or cyclic chart. Okay, so decreasing, increasing, decreasing, increasing, that is called cyclic pattern. Cyclic pattern on the X-bar chart may result from systematic environmental changes such as temperature, operator fatigue, regular rotation of operators or machines, fluctuation in voltage, pressure, or some other variable in the production equipment. R charts will sometimes reveal cycles because of maintenance schedules, operator fatigue, tool wear resulting in excessive variable. Next, mixture pattern. Okay, mixture pattern means, so most of the points will lie nearer this upper control limit and lower control limit. So here you can observe these points are falling nearer the upper control limit. Again, these some points are falling nearer the lower control limit. So this is called mixture pattern. So for this, there might be a reason. Okay, so that engineers need to evaluate. A mixture is indicated when the plotted points tend to fall nearer or slightly outside the control limits. Okay, this is outside, and there are points which are nearer to it. So nearer upper control limit, but they are within the limits, but they are nearer to it. So with relatively few points near the center line. So comparatively, so most of the points are nearer to this upper control limit and lower control limit. Only there might be few exceptions in some charts. Mixtures result from over control, where the operators make process adjustments too often, responding to random variation in the output rather than systematic causes. Okay, when you are operating a machine, okay, if you go on varying the input parameters, okay, that may result in mixture pattern. Next, shifts. Okay, so shifts may result from the introduction of new workers, changes in methods, raw materials or machines, a change in the inspection method or standards, or a change in either the skill, attentiveness or motivation of the operators. Okay, so here you can see after this, there's a shift. That means all points are falling below the center line. This is the center line. All points are falling below this. So this is a shift. So trends. So by looking at this, you can see there's an increasing trend from starting from here. If like this, that will be a decreasing trend. Okay, trends are usually due to a gradual wearing out or deterioration of a tool or some other critical process component. They can also result from human causes such as operator fatigue or the presence of supervision and seasonal influences such as temperature. Stratification. It is a tendency for the points to cluster artificially around the center line. So here you can see points are nearer the center line. If it is natural, no problem. But if looks like so artificially points are falling like this, so then you can have doubt. So there is a marked lack of natural variability in the observed pattern. One potential cause of stratification is incorrect calculation of control limits. Okay, so you might have calculated control limits, you might have plotted the chart, and you may be getting point nearer to this center line only. Okay, but that doesn't mean the process is in control and everything is fine. Again, you can have a doubt, like, okay, so if it is not natural. Next, okay, problems. I will two problems I will explain in